For thousands of people confined to a wheelchair, just a simple trip to the grocery store is a challenge. Imagine traveling across the country in a wheelchair on a ventilator and setting a Guinness Book World Record doing it. That's what Matthew Eddy of Massachusetts did. He started in Lynn, Massachusetts, and drove his wheelchair to Long Beach, California. It took him 126 days, 4 hours, and 2 minutes. He completed the journey last October and was awarded the Guinness Book record for crossing the U.S. by wheelchair. He's the first person to do it. Matt Eddy is 34 years old and joins us now in the studio. He cannot breathe without a ventilator, so you can hear some of the noise of that ventilator in the background. But welcome, Matt. Thanks for coming in.
How you doing?
Matt, first, tell us what put you in a wheelchair and what's your range of movement like?
I was born with Duchenne muscular dystrophy, which is a disease that where your muscles get weaker as time goes on. So I started off like any other kid, walked till I was 10, and now my movements have gone down to very minimal. I can just move my hands enough to use the wheelchair and a mouse for the computer, and that's pretty much all I can do now.
Then why did you do this? It's such a huge undertaking with your limitations to travel all the way across the country.
I don't know. It was just a crazy idea I had one day. I was walking down Lynn Beach with a friend of mine, and I said, you know, wouldn't it be crazy if I drove my chair from here all the way to California? And that was back in, like, I believe 2002 I first had the idea, and nothing ever happened. And every few years I'd ask Ron, who takes care of me, if we could do it. And he's like, no, I can't do it. We can't do it. And then this was the attempt last year. It was actually my second time driving the chair across the country. The first time we did it in 2008, it was just the way things were going. I just kind of jokingly said it again to Ron that, you don't want to try this? And he's like, oh, okay, let's do it. So then it actually happened back then, and we originally did it in a van and slept in tents every night. And then after the first time, Ron kept asking me, and occasionally he's like, let's do it again. And I'm like, no, I can't do that again. He's like, come on. So I said, I'll do it again if I can set a Guinness Book World Record and you get an RV. So
sounds fair.
Yeah. So we got an RV, and I didn't have to sleep in tents and campgrounds anymore. And it made it a little bit easier, but it's still a pretty tough journey. And what made this one tough too was having a camera, because I had the video the whole trip to prove that I did it. So there were all kinds of some malfunctions we had, but we somehow made it through, and I got the record.
Well, congratulations on that.
Thanks.
And you talked about your friend Ron. He's also your caregiver, Ron Steenbruggen, who's joining us. Ron Steenbruggen, who accompanied you on the cross-country journey and also joins us now in the studio. Ron, how was your reaction when he said, let's try it again?
At first, I didn't think he was going to do it, but then I was like, let's do it. So just worked out and raised some money, well, saved some money, got the RV, and then applied to Guinness Book. But the Guinness Book approval process, everybody thinks, oh, just do it and go send it. Well, it's not, you know, just do it and send it. It's you need to get approved through them first, and they set up guidelines, and you have to go by their guidelines. And their guidelines were videotaping the whole trip as he drove. So we had a custom-made camera mount that was mounted on his chair, and we had to get signatures. So everywhere we went, when we saw people, we had to get them to sign a book or whatever. But we also
I understand they signed the RV.
Yeah, it was a way to raise some money too, because we'd like give a buck and sign the truck. So they would sign the RV, and you know, we'd get $1 or $10 or whatever that people had.
And Matt, I understand the purpose of the trip was also to raise awareness for people with major disabilities who want to live at home, and that. And tell me your story about that and why that's important to you.
Well, because I'm vent dependent, I need a lot more care. So when I was first Had the tracheotomy surgery. I was stuck in a hospital for 5 months because usually a lot of us end up in the hospital because not only is it hard to find affordable, accessible housing, it's also hard to find personal caregivers. So a friend of mine who worked as a social worker told me about an apartment, so I got an apartment and managed to get a bunch of people together to take care of me and got out of the hospital 11 years ago.
And Ron, you're his caregiver, and you. So what's your perspective on the living in a hospital or an institution versus living at home for somebody who has major disabilities?
Well, I'm a respiratory therapist. That's how I met him when he got trached and put on the vent. That's what I do is a vent rehab. I'm a vent rehab specialist. So I try to get either people off the ventilator if they get trached because of a chronic illness or an injury or whatever. We try to wean them off the vent. And then if we can't wean them off the vent, we try to find the best placement for them. And usually the placement ends up being, an institutionalized setting, chronic care facility or state hospital, that kind of thing. And it's just, young people, there's just no way for them to live. You don't have any freedom or anything. When he first went home, came out, it was hard to keep people to, they trained family members and friends, whatever, but when they figured out what it really involved, we had 14 people and it lasted 2 weeks. After 2 weeks, we were down to four. Because people were just even though they were trained, they just didn't realize,
how much care is involved.
He's totally dependent on somebody, so.
But you said, though, that he wasn't expected, that you said that Matt wasn't expected to live as long as he has, even because of his condition.
Yeah, his disease, typically, they die in their late teens or early 20s. And it's usually early 20s if they opt to be vented, trached and vented, because a lot of kids with Duchenne's choose not to do that, and then they pass away. But
do you think living in a residential setting has contributed to his better quality of life?
Oh, definitely, because I know, because I still work in that arena on a, part-time basis or per diem basis, and when you look at the advent of these super bugs that they talk about, the bacterial infections that are resistant to antibiotics, if you look at statistics from the CDC, it's 100% of people with a severe physical disability will pick up one of those super bugs, and 30% of them die. They don't die from whatever's wrong with them, like their injury or their illness. They die from the infections. So outliving that is a huge, huge plus for living on your own.
Matt, let's go back to the journey. You crossed 12 states, covered 3,287 miles. What route did you take? Were they small back roads?
Yeah, I couldn't take any major highways because plus, first, you're not allowed to, and second, it's just too dangerous.
Yeah.
So the beginning of the trip, I started in Linden, and I headed to Route 20, and I took Route 20 all the way to Ohio.
So going via back roads, you must have met a lot of people. What was the reaction of the people who met you along the way?
People were very nice, supportive. A lot of people are like, aren't you, you're crazy. I can't believe you're doing it.
And then what was your perspective of America from a wheelchair?
There's definitely no better way to see the country than at 6 miles an hour. You get to see so much stuff going on and it's amazing.
Yeah, like what? Tell me a story.
Well, one of the first ones, I didn't actually see it, but when I was going, there was an 18-wheeler without its trailer on, and it, some reason that people were driving slow behind me because I was kind of in a skinnier road, so they couldn't really get around. So this one truck came flying, stopped, and I guess he ended up wiping out and skidding around a barn behind me, and he missed me by probably 50 feet or so. And they said that, they're like, did you see that? And I'm like, nope, and I just kept going.
And you also faced rattlesnakes, scorpions, searing heat.
The heat in it is, it's pretty intense.
Was there a moment when you thought, I can't do this? What was I thinking? Take me home.
When it was cold, I really was like, I can't do this. And then when it's 120, I'm like, oh, I can't do this either.
When his wheelchair tires were melting to the road, I was like, I don't know if we can keep going on this.
Yeah,
you know?
In Kansas,
that's what happened.
It really happened. It was so hot, it was like 105 for a week straight.
Where?
In Kansas, just in the middle of Kansas. And one day, I was driving and we had to change my tires because they melted to the road.
Wow. And Matt, what did you learn about this country and how people treat and view people with disabilities, with a major disability such as yours?
Well, first, a lot of shock people, but for the most part, you'd be amazed how nice the majority of the people in this country are when you're doing something like this.
And what about for you, Ron? What was your takeaway from this journey?
Yeah, the people we met, and I mean, everybody that we saw were just incredible. It's like, it's not what is kind of portrayed in the media, how people are and this and this and whatever. But everybody we saw was, they couldn't have been nicer, you know? And a lot of people, they just kind of like were just looking at them because you don't see, somebody like Matt, a wheelchair ventilator out, in a cornfield or, even going through a town or a city or whatever, they just don't see it. And to see him is like, oh, good for you, and it was kind of cool.
Matthew Eddy has Duchenne muscular dystrophy and is confined to a wheelchair, but that didn't stop him from driving his wheelchair across the country and setting a Guinness Book World Record. Matt, thanks so much for coming in to talk with us about it.
No problem.
And Ron Steenbruggen is Matt's respiratory therapist and accompanied him on this trip. Thank you.
Thank you.